This is a selection of slides shown during a talk given on April 3rd. There are four parts. First, some general remarks about the discrete, then about systolic geometry, and about a new definition of geodesics, and finally about wave fronts. A meta theme is to show how many things can be pushed from the continuum to the discrete. You might be a finitist and not believe in infinity, or you might want to quantize space for quantum gravity. Here is a nice octa-cube sculpture seen at the math department at Penn State. It is the 24-cell three-dimensional sphere. It's one of the six platonic solids in 4D. We do not know the nature of space, and we will never know. There could be worlds like in fantasy. Another motivation to look at the discrete is to escape from the Grundlagen. What if somebody would prove that Zermelo-Frenkel is inconsistent? The problem, fundamental difficulty, is that we cannot prove consistency of CF within the system itself. In part two, we look at some systolic questions. I want to show some work of James Chen, who worked on discrete systolic geometry. The length of the shortest homotopically non-trivial curve is called the systole in a manifold. And you can ask, what is the maximum of S squared over A? Classically, for the torus, Charles Lerner has shown that S squared over A is always smaller or equal than 2 over square root of 3, with the optimal case known. Here's an example in the discrete where the ratio is 1/2. James found an example with constant 2 over third, and it's likely the optimal case. It's a flat torus in the discrete. In general, he showed that it's smaller or equal to 1, but believes that 2/3 is the constant. Classically, a student of Lerner Poo has shown that the systolic ratio is pi over 2 for the projective plane. In the discrete, James found an example with 4/5. Also classically, about 40 years ago, one has seen that pi over square root of 8 is optimal. Example of James in the discrete gives a ratio 4 over 7. For higher genus surfaces, many questions are open, and also for higher dimensional manifolds, one of the theorems one knows is that for any dimension, there is a constant that works for any of the manifolds. In part three, I want to talk a little bit more about this new geodesics I have been mentioning a couple of times already. One of the fundamental challenges for usual naive geodesics is that there is always a very short radius of injectivity, and also that we don't have a dynamics. A couple of years ago, I worked on a geodesic flow where in the discrete, where we have the possibility to continue in a natural way, so-called Eulerian graphs. There's a lot of work now done in the case of triangular grid billiards, especially Colin Defont has some nice papers. Here's a student at MIT has studied the number of cycles in such triangular grid billiards. Back to this definition I'm studying now, which is a dynamics on oriented maximal simplices, and it's a permutation on oriented maximal simplices. Here are more pictures of this. This is the case of a billiard where you have reflections at the boundary. And here is another example. It's pretty simple definition, and it gives us a permutation on oriented maximal simplices. Here, triangles. And here is an example of a two-dimensional sphere, discrete two-dimensional sphere, where we don't have a boundary. Fundamental questions are whether positive curvature manifolds in the discrete correspond to positive curvature manifolds which we have in the continuum, or whether sufficiently pinched, orientable, connected positive curvature manifolds are spheres. Here's a list of the known positive curvature manifolds, even dimensional positive curvature manifolds. There are also lots of questions which you have in the continuum, mostly here Hamiltonian, in a Hamiltonian setup or billiards in particular. Some of these problems can be translated to the discrete, like the Gilmour problem. If T and S are conjugated billiard maps, question is whether the tables are similar. I found examples of manifolds which are not graphs, which are not isomorphic, but which have isomorphic billiards. About sectional curvature, that's crucial in order to define positive curvature. So one can do that once we have a geodesic flow. In part four, I want to talk about wave fronts, especially about work done with Emily Kang in the case of flat structures, like if you are in a rectangle and you let light flow, then you have a wavefront, and this wavefront becomes complicated with time. The question we were studying is whether the wavefront becomes dense. This happens in this case. Also on a flat torus, on a cliff or torus, the wavefronts become dense. Or on the cube. This was the original question we started with. Also, in this case, the wavefronts become dense. Once we have a geodesic flow, we can also study that in the finite, and we expect that in most cases, the wavefront fills out the full manifold.